Thank you all for coming out here today. I'm David Niosi, the Executive Director of the Humanist Legal Society, and I'd like to welcome you all to this, our inaugural event. We have a great program here today, and we'll get to our panelists in just one moment. But since this is our very first public activity, I wanted to say just a few words about the Humanist Legal Society. The society was created by a group of lawyers from the American Humanist Association who noticed that the legal profession, or the legal community, has many men and women who seem to be humanists. That is, they're not very religious, they value reason and science, they hold generally progressive views about many issues. But we also noticed that there was no group to help humanist lawyers network, organize, claim their place at the table in the public law and policy debate. So that's what the Humanist Legal Society aims to do. One of the society's main goals is to see open humanists become more influential and more prevalent in the law. Now, the need for visible humanism and humanists is obvious when you look around the hyper-religious realm of politics and policymaking in America. We feel that a national membership organization of humanist lawyers can help bring visibility to the secular humanist demographic. It's our plan to have local grassroots chapters in law schools and in major cities around the country. Humanism, if you're wondering, simply holds that you can be a good person by using and developing your innate humanity, by applying reason, empathy, and compassion. One can lead a full life and contribute much to society without God belief or claims of divine revelation or promises of eternal rewards or punishments. Modern humanism follows in the tradition of pragmatism. It is not doctrinaire. Prominent humanists who've been connected with the American Humanist Association, for example, run the range from Kurt Vonnegut and Katharine Hepburn yesterday to Gloria Steinem and Dan Savage today, and many, many others. One thing humanists have in common is that they are highly skeptical of people claiming values derived from ancient texts, claiming to know what God wants, and insisting that they have the right to impose their biblical beliefs and values on the rest of us. So, if you're interested in learning more about the Humanist Legal Society or joining the Humanist Legal Society, I encourage you to visit our website. That's humanistlegalsociety.org. There are also materials on your chairs when you came in here today. You can take a look at those, and I believe there's even membership forms on the chairs. So, anyway, without further ado, at this time, let me introduce the panel that we're all here for today. All three are prominent constitutional authorities and activists. Maya Rupert is Senior Director of Policy and Managing Director of the DC office of the Center for Reproductive Rights. Maya previously served as senior policy advisor to Secretary Julian Castro at the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. Maya also served as chief of staff and senior counsel in the Office of General Counsel at HUD. And previously, Maya was policy director at the National Center for Lesbian Rights. She received her JD from UC Berkeley and clerked for Judge Eric L. Clay of the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals. Shannon Minter is a transgender man and has served as the legal director of the National Center for Lesbian Rights for nearly 20 years. He has litigated dozens of impact cases around the country affecting LGBT people, including the following Supreme Court cases: Christian Legal Society versus Martinez in 2010, Obergefell versus Hodges, representing married same-sex couples from Tennessee, VL versus EL, a 2016 case, and In Re Pavan, 2017, two post-Obergefell cases resulting in summary reversals of state Supreme Court decisions from Alabama and Arkansas denying full faith and credit to a same-sex parent adoption and refusing to list same-sex spouses as parents on their child's birth certificate. Shannon currently is lead counsel, along with Jennifer Levy from Gay and Lesbian Advocates and Defenders, in two cases challenging President Trump's transgender military ban. And then finally, David Codell is a constitutional lawyer based in Los Angeles who is also serving as the first president of the Humanist Legal Society. David graduated with high honors from Harvard College and Harvard Law School and then clerked for Judge David Tittle on the D.C. Circuit and Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg on the Supreme Court. David previously practiced law with Harvard professor Lawrence Tribe and was a partner at Irell & Manella LLP in Los Angeles. David has had his own constitutional law practice in Los Angeles for more than 15 years and has also served as constitutional litigation director at the National Center for Lesbian Rights and visiting legal director of the Williams Institute at UCLA School of Law. He successfully litigated marriage equality cases in California and many other states and was part of the legal team representing Tennessee same-sex couples in the Supreme Court's Obergefell case. So, with that, I'd like to turn things over to David to get the panel started. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. Welcome, everybody. So happy to see such a large crowd here today. We appreciate your coming. I'm going to just give you a rough outline of the topics that we'll be talking about today, and then we'll get to it. Maya, Shannon, and I are going to divide the topics up and occasionally chirp in, depending on what the other person says. So we're going to start with a couple topics concerning women's rights, and Maya is going to speak about abortion issues, and then also access to contraception. And then we're going to switch to some LGBT issues. Shannon will talk about the status of Obergefell, the marriage equality decision, its status as president, and its reach. I will then talk about free exercise challenges that businesses and individuals have been making regarding whether they have to serve same-sex couples. And then I will speak about Title VII and whether it protects against discrimination based on sexual orientation through its prohibition of sex discrimination. And then Shannon and I will split up the topic of whether Title VII and other statutes, by prohibiting sex discrimination, also prohibit transgender discrimination. And then we're going to turn to some topics that affect women and LGBT people, and mainly talk about state efforts to regulate speech by medical professionals, and it'll become clearer what we mean when we get to that one. So once again, we thank you. The topic today is the Supreme Court after Kennedy. I do want to be clear that it's not the Supreme Court in case Kavanaugh gets on. So we won't be discussing or speculating about who will be the next justice or what that next justice may do. We're really going to be focusing on where is the law today and how might it be affected going forward. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Maya.
Thank you so much for that, and thank you to the Humanist Legal Society for having us here today, and for all of you for being here. This is great. Again, my name is Maya Rupert. I'm the Senior Director of Policy at the Center for Reproductive Rights. My role typically focuses on policy work and legislative and advocacy work, but I'm going to switch gears a little bit today to talk a little bit about some of the cases that we see right now in the pipeline. After Kennedy's announced retirement, obviously there's been a lot of focus on sort of the state of Roe, the future of Roe. So I want to talk a little bit about what cases we anticipate actually sort of going up to the Supreme Court, and really make more of a distinction than I think we do sometimes when we're talking about this between, you know, sort of the fear that Roe could be sort of quote overturned, right? Or, you know, kind of some of the ways that it can just be dismantled. I will say, though, to sort of start, I think that moments like these are it's important that we both don't underreact, and I don't think that we are in danger of that, but also I think not to overreact to kind of a political moment or a sort of a certain moment around a particular retirement or something like that, because I think that particularly when we're talking about access to healthcare, access to abortion, access to reproductive healthcare broadly, as a practical matter, a lot of folks that are sort of living in states and on the ground right now, just because of how many bans we've seen over the course of the last several years, people have been, the states have been the battleground for these issues for a while. And so I think there are seven states right now that have one abortion clinic, right? There are a lot of existing restrictions that stop people from really meaningfully accessing all of their rights. And so I think it's just important to kind of keep that context in mind that while this is a particular moment and it is really important that we think about kind of the direction of things, to not lose sight of the fact that as a practical matter, this issue didn't just become urgent for people and it will not, there's sort of no particular thing that can happen on the Supreme Court that will make it really less urgent for people. I think that this is one of those areas we really just need to remain vigilant. So with that, let me just talk about some of the things that we're kind of seeing coming up. When people talk about Roe getting overturned, typically they're talking about the possibility that the Supreme Court would take a particular kind of case, which generally are these sort of pre-viability bans. And so just for a little bit of context, Roe essentially said there's a constitutional right to access abortion before viability. And viability just meant within the medical clinician's professional judgment when the fetus would be able to survive outside of the womb, which is usually put at about 24 weeks after the woman's last menstrual period, right? So bans that that restrict the access to abortion before that point have been considered unconstitutional. That has not stopped states from passing them. This year, we saw Mississippi and Louisiana both pass 15-week bans, and Iowa passed a 6-week ban. So if you really think about what that is an effective just outright ban on abortion, because 6 weeks after the last menstrual period, most people don't know they're pregnant at that point. And so that is, it effectively ends access, but it also was, sort of presumptively unconstitutional, right? So when lawmakers have passed these bills in the states, they've actually a lot of times been sort of conveniently clear that the goal of these is to get a vehicle to overturn Roe. People have gone on the record saying that the Iowa legislation went through, one of the lawmakers explicitly said the goal here is to get a case that we can have overturn Roe. The organizations that have really sort of masterminded the strategy have said we are trying to create a mechanism to put this back in front of the Supreme Court so they can make a determination around that. So there is a case that is in the pipeline right now, the Mississippi case. It has been blocked by a temporary restraining order at the district court level, and it's still at the district court level. So it's not something that's moving super quickly. It hasn't sort of gone up to the circuit courts yet, but there is a case out there that could put this issue before the court. I will say that I think most people, and I agree, do not think that this is the most likely case to be sort of the next thing for the court newly constituted to deal with. I think for a couple of reasons. One is timing. It is, before the district court right now, but it has a few more steps to go. But I think the second thing is, and it's important to remember, I think the Supreme Court does take its sort of role and reputation as a non-political body seriously, and this would be a very big swing to take. To take a case where, particularly where there have been statements on the record where the idea is to try to overturn Roe, to take a case like that, that would be an incredibly aggressive activist move and something that I don't think the Supreme Court necessarily wants to do, and really that they kind of have to, right? Because there are a lot of other cases that could really sort of get at the heart of what Roe, Casey, and Whole Women's Health have done without explicitly overturning the decision. So another sort of type of case that we're seeing a lot are these abortion method bans. And basically these are banning a particular method, DNE, which is it's sort of the most common and safest method of abortion after early in the second trimester. That states, there are 8 states right now that have actually just banned that specific method. And that's important because, again, a number of, ACOG, a number of similar medical associations have said that without DNE, a lot of the methods that sort of remain for performing an abortion are, you know, risky, are sort of less well tested. So this really does sort of get to the safety of abortion, whether it really meaningfully remains accessible to people without having to undergo undue risk. So those bans, you know, we've seen a number of states pass them. A number of lawsuits are pending challenging those. And those cases are moving a little bit quicker through the pipeline. There's a case that has been appealed to the 11th Circuit and is waiting a decision, one in the 5th Circuit and one in the 8th Circuit. So I think that we will see in coming months decisions coming out around those, and that potentially could be a pathway for the Supreme Court to take a look at this issue. And then I will talk finally, there are a lot more types of these, but I want to get through a couple of things, so I will limit myself and talk specifically, too, about the defunding of abortion providers. I think a lot of people hear a lot about defunding Planned Parenthood and essentially making it impossible for Planned Parenthood facilities to get reimbursed through Medicaid for performing services. So that sort of, a number of states have passed laws prohibiting the reimbursement of Planned Parenthood facilities through Medicaid, and those are being challenged as well. I think that also presents a pretty square, it's an issue that a number of states are dealing with, and I think it also, you know, it presents what I think is an attractive case for the Supreme Court to take a look at this. So while I think there is risk, and we should take this moment incredibly seriously, I also just want, you know, sort of caution that I think what we will likely see next from the Supreme Court will not squarely say yes or no on Roe. It will kind of get to the kind of, you know, sort of panoply of rights that exist around it that really give Roe its so much of its weight that could potentially sort of be eroded. Switching gears really quickly, I want to talk a little bit about access to contraception, and specifically through the ACA, because that's another area we could see the Supreme Court sort of taking on some of these issues. There are 7 lawsuits that are currently pending, specifically on the recent interim final rules that the administration passed to limit the impact of the no copay contraception coverage provision of the ACA. And, you know, essentially those rules really made it sort of possible for any employer or university to just refuse to comply with the no copay contraception coverage. And so a number of lawsuits are pending there. Two are at the circuit court level in California and Pennsylvania. A number of other district courts are dealing with this issue as well. There is a nationwide preliminary injunction right now against those actually going in against the rules sort of going into place, but I just want to talk briefly about some of the arguments that are being made there. Again, a couple of sort of the I think the one that has gotten a lot of attention because it's where a lot of the courts have sort of focused their energy is really an administrative legal kind of, you know, if you're into administrative law, super interesting, but I think for most people, not the most interesting piece of this of these cases, but it's basically the use of the interim final rule process. Interim final rules, for folks that are less familiar with the way that the administration can make law, basically, typically, an agency can make a regulation, and what they do is they put out a proposed rule, and that rule does not take effect. They say, you know, we want to regulate in X area, and then that it opens a comment period, and the public gets to, it's called, you know, notice and comment. We actually get a chance to read and comment on the rule. The administration then needs to take those comments into consideration and make a determination about whether or not they're going to finalize that rule and any changes they're going to make. An interim final rule is a very rare procedure that allows the administration to immediately make law and then say, you know, we're opening for comment, notice and comment, but in the meantime, this rule is in effect. That is a very rare, typically you don't engage in that with the exception of what's called good cause, which has really only been extended to things where there's sort of a safety issue or kind of a serious public good. There's some emergency that this has to go into place right away. This is not the kind of situation where that tool is typically used. So what we could see is one of these lawsuits sort of going up, but declining to actually rule in sort of the merits of, you know, the Establishment Clause or the Equal Protection Clause or any of the sort of media or constitutional issues that are raised here, because they would be able to say this was not done the proper way and basically remand back for the administration to go through the proper channels. I'm going to stop there, and I apologize because I want to make sure we're able to get through everything we have today. So thank you.
Sure. I wanted to make a comment and ask a question. This concerns abortion. And one of the things that I wonder is that as the composition of the court is changing, whether there will be a change in the types of cases that appear before the court. Justice Ginsburg always says, we can only hear the cases that people bring to us. And I have a bit of a concern that with this uncertainty, when Kennedy was still on the court, even though you could never tell for sure how he would come down on abortion, at least there was an understanding that he appreciated the importance of the privacy right. But if we don't have five justices for whom we know that's true, then I wonder whether women who lose in the lower courts, or abortion providers who lose in the lower courts, or organizations that support abortion rights, I wonder whether they'll be hesitant to bring a case they've lost up to the US Supreme Court, because they risk nationalizing one bad court ruling could suddenly become the law of the land. And I just think that's something for us to keep our eyes out for, to see whether that happens. I don't know if you have some thoughts on that, Shannon, after the LGBT movement's experience with that.
I think that's a very well taken point, David, and I'm sure that will be the case, and that's another way, in addition to losing a sure knowledge that we have five justices that support reproductive autonomy, in addition to the uncertainty that creates in terms of Supreme Court outcomes, I think it will definitely have a chilling impact on federal court litigation and ending up causing more harm to women as a result of bad practices not going challenged.
Yeah, and I think you could end up with a lopsided set of rulings from the Supreme Court on this issue, because one side is going to go running to the Supreme Court at every opportunity, and the other side will be exercising caution as to whether even to bring their case to the court. So I think that's something we should look out for. Maya, thanks so much for your presentation on abortion and access to contraception. We're going to move now to LGBT issues, and we're going to start with Shannon, who is going to talk about Obergefell.
Yeah, so kind of shifting gears a bit to talk about issues of particular concern to LGBT people. I mean, one of the most obvious and important is marriage, and in particular, you know, what will be the fate of Obergefell versus Hodges, which I think was probably the centerpiece of Justice Kennedy's gay rights jurisprudence. He authored that decision in 2015, joined by Breyer, Ginsburg, Kagan, and Sotomayor, and of course, that decision held that same-sex couples have the same fundamental right to marry as others. Uncharacteristically, Chief Justice Roberts actually read his dissent from the bench, and also uncharacteristically, it was quite emphatic, I think is the word I'll use there. I think so, given the closeness of the decision and the Chief Justice's strong dissent, I mean, naturally the question is coming up, would a future court, without Kennedy, actually go so far as to reverse Obergefell and permit states to once again exclude same-sex couples from marriage? You know, while anything is possible, I do think that's unlikely for three reasons. And the first is that same-sex couples have been able to marry for more than 10 years in some states and for at least 3 years in every state. There's a recent study that found that 10% of LGBT adults are now married to a same-sex spouse. Many of those are raising children. I mean, the impact of a decision reversing Obergefell on those families would just be devastating, but it would also lead to, I think, an almost unimaginable level of legal chaos. You would have employers, health insurers, pension plans, state and local governments. They would be left in limbo about the validity of existing marriages. There would be all kinds of questions about interstate recognition of marriages. The courts would just be flooded with litigation trying to sort through all of these claims. And I just think the sheer disruption that would result would be really quite enormous. So I think the second reason that I think a reversal is not likely is I don't think the Supreme Court is likely to reverse a decision that would cause, when that would cause so much social turmoil. I mean, at this point, two-thirds of the American public supports marriage equality. And then if you look at the 18 to 36-year-old age range, that number rises almost to 75%. I think if the court were to suddenly just strip away the right to marry for same-sex couples, we would just undoubtedly, I think, see very widespread outrage, disapproval, backlash. Some states, I think we would see very sustained protests, even civil disobedience. There would be pressure on public officials to resist the court's ruling, and I think some would do that. I just think the strain on our nation's social fabric would be quite significant. And think, too, if you think about, I think in the court's recent history, at least, it has never voted to completely take away a fundamental right that it has recognized for a minority group. And for the court to do that now, it wouldn't just be shocking for social and political reasons, but it would actually be a pretty drastic departure from the court's kind of core precedent, sort of core operating principles. So, you know, notwithstanding the Chief Justice's dissent in Obergefell, I think he's likely to want to protect the court from that kind of institutional harm. And, of course, his vote would be needed to reverse Obergefell. I think he may have signaled that he's not particularly inclined to do that recently when he kind of pointedly declined to join the Gorsuch dissent in the Pavan versus Smith case, which David talked about. That's a case just from 2017, just last year, where the court ruled that, yes, Obergefell meant what it said and that states have to treat married same-sex couples equally. And that case was about birth certificates. But there was a very strong Gorsuch dissent, and the Chief Justice did not join it. And then more recently, I think David's going to talk about more about this in a moment, but Roberts joined the majority opinion in Masterpiece Cake Shop, which is just full of all kinds of language affirming, quote, gay persons and gay couples cannot be treated as social outcasts or as inferior in dignity and worth. I mean, there's much more language along those lines in that decision. And I think by signing on to an opinion that is so strongly affirming the equality of same-sex couples, I think at a minimum the Chief Justice has made reversing Obergefell a much heavier institutional lift.
All right, so let's have a little discussion about Obergefell before we move on to our next topic. Well, I think one interesting thing about Kennedy leaving the court is that we're going to hear from some voices in writing that we haven't heard from before. And let me explain. The four biggest precedents from the Supreme Court on LGBT rights, well, really LGB rights, are cases in which Justice Kennedy wrote the majority opinion, going all the way back to Romer versus Evans, and then when the Texas sodomy law was overturned, and then when DOMA was struck down, and then when in Obergefell marriage was recognized for same-sex couples throughout the country. Each time, Justice Kennedy wrote the majority opinion. And probably in an effort to show unity, no justice ever wrote a concurring opinion in any of those cases except Justice O'Connor in the very first one, Romer versus Evans. But in the last three cases, the five justices in the majority each time spoke in one voice, Justice Kennedy's voice. And this is a very odd thing because it's obvious that some of the other justices, particularly I think Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who has spent her life fighting for equality, probably has some things she'd like to say. But she's never chosen to say them in these particular cases. And one other aspect of these cases is that Justice Kennedy was really focused on the right to privacy. And so those opinions, even when they alluded to equal protection principles, were never fully decided on equal protection principles. And I'm intrigued by what Justice Ginsburg might think about the Equal Protection Clause when it comes to these issues, because in the abortion context, she's long said that she would have preferred that Roe v. Wade be decided on equal protection grounds rather than on substantive due process grounds. So I will be intrigued to see, now that Kennedy is gone, what some of the other justices will say in opinions about LGBT rights, and I'm particularly hopeful that there'll be a stronger emphasis on the Equal Protection Clause.
All right.
Shall we move on?
Yes.
Oh, well, then that means it's my turn. Okay. So I'm going to talk about next the issue of free exercise of religion claims for the right to discriminate against same-sex couples or LGBT persons. And of course, I'm referring to things like the wedding cake cases, the wedding florist cases, where the Supreme Court just had one called Masterpiece Cake Shop, which I'll talk about briefly. Cases in which there's a generally applicable law that protects people from discrimination when they go about their business at public accommodations, protected against discrimination based on sexual orientation. But there are quite a few cases coming up where people are claiming, businesses are claiming, a free exercise of religion right to refuse to participate in a wedding of a same-sex couple. And one of those cases made it all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court this year. And it came from Colorado. A couple wanted to have a cake for, a same-sex couple wanted to have a cake for a celebration of their marriage. The cake shop owner said no. The Colorado Commission that watches over discrimination ruled against the couple, and I'm sorry, ruled against the bakery, and the bakery lost all the way up through the Colorado courts, and they went to the Supreme Court. Now, I'm going to tell you that the Supreme Court result was sort of a dud to everyone, because people were wondering whether there would be some kind of grand holdings about to what extent can you use a religious free exercise claim to avoid having to serve LGBT people or same-sex couples or participate in a wedding. And there were two types of First Amendment claims, free exercise claim, but also a free speech claim, where the cake maker claimed that having to create this work of art, his cake, would have violated his First Amendment rights. What we got was not a grand, clear holding. Instead, Justice Kennedy was bothered by a comment from a commissioner in Colorado, the first level where the case had been reviewed, that Justice Kennedy interpreted as being not respectful enough of religion. And so he wrote an opinion joined by six of his colleagues that kind of said how important it is for respect to be shown for religion when these claims are considered, and he sent it back, he remanded it. So there was no grand holding of answering in some fundamental way how our society is going to balance these competing claims. But there were some very interesting things in that opinion. I think a lot of people in the LGBTQ community were disappointed that there wasn't some kind of holding that would get rid of these claims, that would just make it clear that, you know, you can't use your religion to not participate in my wedding, etc. But there was also a lot of fear that the court was going to carve out some kind of exception where it's okay to use your religion to discriminate against gay people, even though you can't use your religion to discriminate against other protected categories, such as race. So I'd say there's a couple of things that came out of this opinion if you look carefully at the language. And one of the things is that in the language that Justice Kennedy used in that opinion, again joined by his colleagues, he went to great efforts to stress that the dignity interest that anti-discrimination laws serve for LGBT people are equal to the dignity interests that anti-discrimination laws serve for other groups that are protected. So there was no disparagement of the dignity level for same-sex couples, married same-sex couples. And in fact, the opinion begins with a quote saying, gay persons and gay couples cannot be treated as social outcasts, thanks a lot, or as inferior in dignity and worth. I might have worded that differently, but I'm not on the court. So, but I think the point was important that anti-discrimination laws, where they exist, they protect a certain type of dignity, and it's the same no matter which group is being protected. Also, this is a related point. He didn't do what people feared he would do, LGBT groups feared he would do. He did not carve out some kind of religious claimant exception for LGBT discrimination. In other words, there's nothing in that opinion that you can say suggests that LGBT people that are going to be protected any less against claims of religious discrimination. Instead, the court really kept in place the general rule that applies under constitutional law when someone is trying to use a religious claim to get out of having to comply with a generally applicable law. The case that established that was something written by Antonin Scalia, believe it or not, called Employment Division versus Smith. You might argue around the edges about what some language meant, but really, the court did nothing to disturb that as the still governing framework. I do think that it was a confusing result, not clear. I don't think it cleared up anything. However, as a litigant, when I'm thinking, how do I use this case later, I think these points are key points. The court did not do the things that people were afraid they would do and that religious claimants were asking them to do. So the case turned out not to be it turned out not to be either the bad result we might have feared, nor did it really provide a tool for religious claimants in the future. I don't think this opinion really gives them a hook that they can use later, apart from the ability to contest what they feel is some kind of hostility to religion in the proceedings. I don't know if either of you have any thoughts.
I would go even farther than you've gone. I actually think while it didn't definitively resolve the issue, I think the framework, the doctrinal framework that's laid out in the majority opinion is incredibly protective in terms of future attempts to carve out an exception for sexual orientation discrimination with respect to free exercise or even free speech claims. I mean, court, I think, was very clear in that opinion that any possible such claim to an exception could not result in a denial of goods or services. It couldn't result in the imposition of any kind of stigma or harm. I mean, that's pretty powerful. And if you looked at the briefing from the anti-LGBT groups that have been promoting not only that case but other similar cases and trying desperately to generate as many of them as possible in the hopes of getting some court for the first time in our nation's history to recognize a constitutionally mandated exception to an anti-discrimination, generally applicable anti-discrimination law, that they really were focusing on trying to get the court to say, to hold, that there's a difference between sexual orientation and, I think, by implication, gender discrimination claims on the one hand and race discrimination claims on the other. And the court resisted that unequivocally. And as you just said, David, they were like, no, these anti-discrimination claims are of a piece and the constitutional framework that applies to them is of a piece. So I think it's pretty darn significant, actually.
All right. Any other comments, or should we move on to the next topic? Let's do it. Okay. So the next topic, we're going to talk about whether Title VII and Title IX, which provide protection against discrimination based on sex, should also be interpreted to include discrimination based on sexual orientation. So this is an issue that is quite hot right now, and we'll probably reach the Supreme Court very soon, if not this week. I'm going to describe the issue, and then I'll tell you where things stand, because things are moving very fast this week on that issue. Okay, so just to explain the issue, Title VII is the statute first enacted in 1964 that prohibits discrimination based on a variety of characteristics, including race, but also sex. The language says that an employer cannot discriminate because of an individual's sex. Okay. Now, that nobody knows for sure what people thought that would mean back in 1964, because the people who put that in there were actually trying to kill the bill instead of save it. This is the theory of many historians. But I think its first point is that, look, the statute doesn't mention sexual orientation by its terms. And it's probably likely that few members of Congress at that time even thought about whether it would protect against discrimination based on sexual orientation. However, throughout the history of that provision, all sorts of things have come to be understood as discrimination based on sex, even though no one would have ever thought of it at the time. Back at the time, what people were thinking of at the time was, someone gets denied a job, someone doesn't get a promotion. But later, the Supreme Court said, no, it also applies to harassment. Pervasive harassing environment, that's also discrimination based on sex. And if you had told all these mainly male Congress members in 1964 that that's what they were banning, I think they would have been surprised. So advocates have been trying for years, LGBT advocates, to get Congress to pass, when I say years, I mean decades, to get Congress to add sexual orientation to Title VII. It has not happened. And sort of the history here is that if you look at older cases, even going back a few decades and then even coming close to the present, courts didn't take seriously the question or the claim that when you're discriminating against someone based on sexual orientation, you're discriminating against them based on sex. So there were a whole set of court cases saying, no, this does not protect LGBT people against discrimination based on sexual orientation. The tide began to change recently because the Equal Opportunity Commission, the EEOC, took a fresh look at the issue and examined, well, what is sexual orientation discrimination exactly? And in a series of cases, they eventually reached the conclusion, finally, fully, in July 2015, and they held that the ban on sex discrimination also prohibits sexual orientation discrimination. And I'd like to walk through some of the ways, some of the reasoning that explains that. So I'm going to give three points that help support this notion. The first is that sexual orientation is inherently a sex-based consideration. The definition of sexual orientation takes into account the sex of the person to whom one is attracted or with whom one wants to have a relationship. The characteristic itself is inseparable from sex. So that's one point. A second point is that discriminating based on sexual orientation is an associational form of discrimination, in this case, sex discrimination. And let me explain it in another way. Here's a basic point. Title VII prohibits discrimination based on race. It would also prohibit your boss from firing you because your spouse was a certain race. Title VII's protection against sex discrimination also includes an associational protection. And this is the exact same parallel with sexual orientation. The person who is being targeted for discrimination, who's fired because the boss finds out that he has a husband or she has a wife or girlfriend, is firing that person based on their association with someone. And so that is another theory, but explanation of how sexual orientation discrimination is a form of sex discrimination. And then a third very important point in this regard is that discrimination based on sexual orientation is very frequently, and I mean very frequently, based on gender-based stereotypes or expectations. And the Supreme Court, in a case called Waterhouse v. Hopkins, ruled that Title VII's sex discrimination prohibition also didn't mean it meant that you could also be fired if you weren't being feminine enough and you're a woman. That what Title VII protects against is not just what is your sex, But if you get fired or demoted or treated badly in your job because if you're a woman, your boss doesn't think you're feminine enough, or if you're a man, your boss doesn't think you're manly enough, that is a form of prohibited discrimination. Well, that is the same type of thing that happens when people discriminate based on sexual orientation. Discrimination based on sexual orientation is based on the stereotype that a man should partner with a woman, or the stereotype that a woman should partner with a man, or should be attracted to a man, or should form household with a man. And so the logic that supports Price Waterhouse also supports a conclusion that laws that protect against sex discrimination also protect against sexual orientation discrimination. Well, in 2017, the Seventh Circuit, the Court of Appeals that covers Illinois, Indiana, and Wisconsin, had a case, and they ruled. All the judges got together en banc and decided to overturn all their old precedents, and they held that discrimination based on sexual orientation is covered by Title VII. That case did not go up to the Supreme Court. It got sent back down to the trial court. It's in the trial court now. Well, earlier this year in February, by the way, that created a conflict with all those other cases. So there's definitely a circuit conflict on this now. Well, then the Second Circuit in February of this year did the same thing. They went in bank, they overturned all their old rulings on this question, and they held that sexual orientation discrimination is prohibited by Title VII. So that case, there's now a cert petition in the Supreme Court right now on that case. Well, things didn't go so well in another recent case in the 11th Circuit. The 11th Circuit just said, no, we're going to keep our old precedents in place. No protection for LGBT people under Title VII. Just yesterday, that court denied en banc rehearing. And just this week, the losing plaintiff filed a cert petition in the Supreme Court. So the Supreme Court this week has two cases in front of it. One from the Second Circuit saying sexual orientation discrimination is banned by Title VII, and one from the 11th Circuit saying no, it isn't. So this has been set up as a conflict. So I think it would not be surprising if the court were to take this question up. The court could decide to let more courts consider it. During the marriage equality struggle, there was a point where four different circuits had struck down marriage bans, but the court didn't take the case. It wanted to hear from more courts. So you can't always predict for sure what will happen. But this thing is definitely keyed up for decision. I don't know if you guys want to weigh in.
No, I think you nailed it on that one. Yeah. It's quite nerve-wracking having those cert petitions out there. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so now we're going to turn to a very related issue, which is whether Title VII, its ban on sex discrimination, protects against gender identity discrimination. So a similar question. When statutes like Title VII say you cannot discriminate because of an individual's sex, does that protect transgender people? Well, you might not expect this, but actually, transgender plaintiffs have been having a much easier time on this issue than LGB plaintiffs. As before with sexual orientation, in the old days, decades ago, these claims were rejected. When transgender people tried to get protection under the statutes, they were rejected. But over time, many courts came to understand that when you're discriminating against someone based on their gender identity, it is a form of sex discrimination. And so we now have positive rulings on this by the 5th, 6th, 7th, 9th, and 11th circuits at least. That's at least five. And not only that, they don't just concern Title VII. They concern Title IX, which governs funding for schools. They include the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare, also the Fair Housing Act, the Equal Credit Opportunity Act, and other statutes. So this issue is actually succeeding. We're on a roll on this issue. I'll give you just three quick ways in which discrimination based on gender identity is also sex discrimination. First,
just as a matter of text, when these statutes ban discrimination based on sex, they don't say biological sex or sex assigned at birth, they just say sex. Well, in regular sex discrimination cases, the courts have explained that these statutes that use the word sex also protect based on gender. And so even outside the context of gender identity, it's understood in the case law that these sex discrimination statutes include not just your biological sex, but also gender-based things, such as whether you want to call it, I guess you could call it social or cultural or personal aspects of femininity or masculinity. And that's why sex discrimination bans include things like prohibiting discrimination for being too feminine or for not being feminine enough. Another way in which gender identity discrimination is sex discrimination is that it is also based on gender-based expectations and stereotypes, just as we discussed before. It's based on the assumption that what you're born is to define how you live your life, how you present yourself to the world. And so it's based on stereotypes, which is not permitted under Title VII or these other statutes. And then, of course, there's one other context in which it's the discrimination based on gender identity is a clear form of sex discrimination. And that has to do with transitioning. When someone is transitioning, say from a man to a woman or a woman to a man, say you're working at a job one day, you're presenting as a woman, you transition, you now present as a man, and you get fired, I think it's pretty obvious you're being fired for a sex-based reason. So those cases are going well. They are controversial in some contexts, even though the courts are open to them. They're controversial in some contexts. We all hear about the bathroom cases all the time. Bathroom cases both in public accommodations contexts, but often in the school context. The Obama administration issued guidance to schools that said that Title IX's prohibitions of sex discrimination should entitle students in public schools to use a restroom that coincided with their gender identity. Betsy DeVos dumped that guidance. There was a case that could have been decided by the Supreme Court, but after that guidance changed, that case went back to the lower courts. So this case is in the courts. I'm going to pause here and let Shannon pick up on transgender issues.
Okay, yeah. Hey, one quick correction, because it's just like a verbal typo. You said when you were listing off all the courts of appeal that have recognized that anti-transgender discrimination and sex discrimination, you said fifth, you meant first.
Not the fifth.
Okay. Yeah, well, they might. They might.
That's not in my notes.
I hope they will, but they haven't yet. Yeah, so it's not quite yet.
Thank you.
It's the first. Yeah, no problem. I just want a really quick note on that. Like, courts have held it the same way that it would clearly be discrimination based on religion if an employer fired you because you had converted from one religion to another, similar to that somebody's fired for going through a gender transition. It's plainly based on their sex. But yeah, I do want to talk about the transgender military ban case. It's certainly possible that one or more of the cases challenging President Trump's transgender military ban may reach the court. And I think a concern that some folks have is that the court's recent ruling in the travel ban case may not bode well for those challenges. In the travel ban case, the court, and I'm talking about the anti-Muslim travel ban case, you know, the court showed extreme, some would say abject, deference to the president's authority and upheld a travel ban that is widely recognized, acknowledged to discriminate against Muslim people. And while that case is of grave concern both on its own, it also does raise questions about how the court might deal with a transgender military ban. I will say there is an important difference between those two cases. I mean, with the travel ban, we had the president, you know, repeatedly publicly stating over and over again that his intention in implementing that ban was to discriminate against Muslim people, to keep Muslim people out of the country. At the same time, the actual text of the policy itself never expressly referred to Muslim people, and and especially in its final iteration, it did include some non-majority Muslim countries. And that created enough of a fig leaf to allow the court to say that that was a facially neutral policy, and therefore all the president's comments, which the court did acknowledge in the decision, that all those comments had no legal significance because the court was evaluating a policy that did not overtly, expressly, on its face, discriminate on the basis of someone being a member of the Muslim religion. The military ban on its face is about transgender people. So this is not a situation where we have to rely on the president having tweeted, as he did, that he's never going to, transgender people will never be allowed to serve in the military in any capacity. Even if he hadn't tweeted that, the policy itself is expressly classifies based on a person's transgender status. That's going to, the court's going to have to grapple with that when, you know, if this case, if any of these cases ever reach them. And it's also a note here that there is Supreme Court precedent from an older case from 1981 called Rosker, where the Supreme Court held that notwithstanding the deference that courts afford to military authorities and to the president when he or she is making military policy, that if you have a policy that facially discriminates based on sex, and all of the four federal district courts that have analyzed the transgender ban so far, for the reasons that all these other courts that David was talking about, same reason, have concluded that it is a sex-based ban. It's a ban based on a sex-based characteristic. So we have the Supreme Court precedent saying that when that's the case, even if it's a military policy, that the Supreme Court will analyze that under the same heightened level of equal protection scrutiny they would apply if it was in the civilian context. So the court's going to have to deal with that precedent as well. And then last, but I think definitely not least, now, while it is true that the president does have significant authority over military policy making, it is so unusual for a military policy to single out a whole group of people based on a personal characteristic, and that is so deeply antithetical to the way military policy normally operates, which is otherwise 100% individualized assessments, merit-based analyses of whether a person is fit to serve. And this, don't do this for any other group of people. And I think even a very conservative court is going to be given serious pause by a policy like that. So while I am concerned about the fate of these cases should they reach the high court, I also think there's still grounds for some considerable optimism there.
And can I just add, because David, you mentioned the ACA and some of the success we've seen, which is very true. The ACA has a non-discrimination provision called, it's Section 1557, that prohibits discrimination based on sex. And in subsequent regulations that were issued under the Obama administration, they clarified that discrimination on the basis of sex would include discrimination on the basis of gender identity. The Trump administration has indicated that they are planning to reissue new regulations around the ACA, specifically around 1557, and I don't think anyone would be sort of bowled over if they decided to reverse that. So I think we also might see, I would imagine something like that would, you know, face similar challenges to the challenges that have been brought against the interim final rules around the contraception coverage. I imagine people will, sort of come forward to challenge that on a number of bases, including, I think, the APA requires that rules like this not be sort of arbitrary and capricious. The fact that this was, you know, a regulation that was issued, that it had a huge notice and comment period. They actually went back a couple of times and had people sort of resubmit comments, that there was an intense amount of work that went into that, and that it was so supported by federal case law, that if the Trump administration decides to reverse that, I think there would be a very strong argument that that decision was an arbitrary and capricious one.
Do you want to turn to...
I'm up next. You're right. I forgot the order. Yes. I'm happy to talk a little bit about. We're going to talk a little bit about. Think about compelled speech for professionals, and I'm going to start, and then turn over to Shannon. But there was recently a case that was decided by the Supreme Court. This is the NIFLA case, if folks have heard about it. I want to talk a little bit about that and what that holding means. This case concerned crisis pregnancy centers, which essentially are these basically fake women's clinics that engage in a number of sort of deceptive practices to try to get people who are trying to get access to reproductive health care, abortion, contraception, to sort of come to these centers, which actually do not provide those services and are against those services, but to either, you know, kind of engage in like deceptive internet practices, so getting names that are super close to another website so that, you know, if you Google, you'll see one and click on it, and, you know, sort of having a website that looks like, oh, this might be a women's clinic, maybe this is where I want to go. And when you go, they actually counsel people out of trying to access contraception or have abortions. Very often just flat out lie. A lot of these clinics do not have, they're not licensed. These are not medical professionals a lot of times. Sometimes there are, but very, very often they don't have, they're not licensed to provide any kind of medical care. And so people sort of come in with one idea and then are strongly discouraged and lied to about potential health risks and things like that, and very often sort of leave without accessing the care that they came there for and that they need. So because this was happening in 2015, California passed what they called the FACT Act, and it did two things. The first is it required for the versions of these crisis pregnancy centers, CPCs, the versions of the CPCs that were not licensed and didn't have medical professionals on staff to post something that says, we are not a licensed medical provider. You know, the people that are counseling you are not licensed medical, you know, they're not practitioners. The second piece was for the CPCs that did have licensed clinicians on site, they had to post something that said, you might, you know, you may be eligible, if you're a low income, you may be eligible for certain programs that would provide abortion, contraception coverage, maternity care for you at sort of reduced costs. And the reason for that was there were a number of people who were being basically, you know, sort of targeted. What they would do is say, oh, come in here for a free screening. Are you pregnant? Come and get like a free ultrasound or whatever. And so they were really targeting low-income women. They were targeting women of color, and they were getting people to come in and then, you know, sort of getting them not to access the care they needed. So this was an effort to say, listen, if you're here because they're telling you can save money, you might be eligible for those services through the state. So that's what the act required. The CPC said, well, this is a violation of our free speech. You're compelling us to speak. And so they sued. And recently, the Supreme Court ruled and actually struck down both provisions of the FACT Act. So it was a disappointing ruling, but I think there are a couple of really important pieces to keep in mind. The first is that for the unlicensed piece of the act, so the people who were not licensed professionals, the Supreme Court struck that down. But what they said was the reason is you can't, you know, that California had not done a good enough job proving that the problem here was that women were being deceived into coming into these clinics. So it's sort of a factual issue, and not with they declined to say, and in fact said that, you know, the something like that for saying we're unlicensed would not be presumptively unconstitutional under the First Amendment. The issue here was that it wasn't abundantly clear that that was really the issue, and that sort of fixing that was really going to solve the problem. So importantly, if a state does want to regulate these things with respect to people who are not licensed, there does seem to be a way under NIFLA to continue doing that. They would just need to do more work to prove up that the issue here was deceptive practices. People were coming in thinking they were going to get access to one kind of care and then not getting that, or thinking that they were coming in and these people were licensed and not, right? So that, I think, is encouraging, because that is horrifying that there are clinics that are lying to people, and the idea that there does remain under this ruling a way to regulate that, I think, is very encouraging. The second piece was licensing for the sort of licensed clinics. And basically what they said is, in order to compel speech in a situation like that, you're going to need to show that this is, you know, sort of non-controversial, which obviously, you know, they basically said you're not able to show, because abortion is controversial. And the second piece was that it would need to be regulating professional conduct that incidentally involve speech. And they said, here, that's not what's going on here. This is a regulation of speech. This is an incidental to something else. Obviously, again, it was a disappointing ruling, and I don't agree with some of the conclusions that are reached there. I think, it's a difficult thing to say that abortion remains controversial in a world where we know that like 7 out of 10 people support the right to access abortion. So it's kind of an odd framing of the issue. But it actually, interestingly, is not sort of fatal, and it's actually, I think, in some ways, lays the groundwork for arguments that abortion rights attorneys can make in other settings. One of the things that we are consistently seeing in states, the center has a case around this right now in Mississippi, that states will require physicians to make assertions to patients who are trying to come in and access abortion. They will say things like, in Mississippi, they require them to say that there's an increased risk of breast cancer associated with having an abortion. That is not, that the American Cancer Society says that is not true. Other medical organizations have said that is not true. And yet, you know, the state passed this law and requires that. So we see, you know, we see that. We see there are states where, you know, there a doctor is required to describe an ultrasound, you know, sort of and make a woman sort of have an ultrasound and sort of verbally describe what this is and what's happening, right? Those are forced speech situations as well. And so if sort of the holding of NIFLA says that, you know, the crisis pregnancy centers cannot be required to tell their patients about some, you know, sort of other options around, you know, actually accessing abortion or accessing contraception. Presumably, then, that's the same reasoning that could be used to go after some of these other forced speech cases that actually prevent people from accessing the care that they need. So, again, I think it's one of these situations where it would have, you know, it was sort of disappointing in the moment, but after we've sort of taken a look at it and seen what else is out in the landscape, it actually really does kind of provide a roadmap for going after some of these kind of other restrictions where the issue is compelled speech. So with that, I would like to turn over to Shannon, who I think is gonna.
Yeah, okay. I can be very brief here, and I really like that analysis, Maya, and I think we're going to have to be more creative in looking at some of these decisions. But NIFLA has also raised concerns about what would happen if the court were to hear a case challenging one of the growing number of state laws that protect LGBT young people from conversion therapy. And those laws are based on a very strong medical consensus that when therapists try to change a young person, stop them from being gay or transgender, not only does it not work, but it is very harmful. It puts those young people at risk of some serious health issues, depression and suicidality included. Two of the laws have been challenged. They've both been upheld, one by the Ninth Circuit, one by the Third Circuit.
Shannon won both those cases.
Yes. Well, I helped. the state attorneys general in both those cases also were the main defenders of those laws. But and the courts in those cases held it wasn't even close. Like, it wasn't even a close call that, of course, states can regulate that type of medical treatment to protect consumers from harm. But there's language, and Justice Thomas wrote the majority opinion, as Maya noted, in NIFLA. There's language in his opinion that is super broad, super sweeping, appears to, you know, throw out the window longstanding doctrine that has held that states do have considerable latitude to regulate professional speech and commercial speech. But I think the good news here is if you read the decision carefully, most of that is dicta. At the end of the day, Justice Thomas says, even assuming the professional speech doctrine still exists, this law, the California law, purportedly, you know, didn't pass muster even under the lower level of scrutiny that the court has for a long time applied to laws that regulate professional speech. But more importantly, for our conversion therapy laws, Justice Thomas, even in this you know, otherwise very sweeping opinion, went out of his way to say that one thing that states still, of course, can do is regulate professional conduct, and in particular, states can still regulate medical treatment, even if that incidentally affects some professional speech. And if you're wondering, well, why didn't that help with the clinic law? That decision also rather remarkably held that what was going on at those clinics was not the provision of medical treatment. How facilitating someone's childbirth cannot be medical treatment, I'm not sure, but that was the rationale of those decisions. But plainly, the conversion therapy laws are about regulating medical treatment. So while I certainly can't assure anyone that a new court, newly constituted court, would uphold these laws, I do think I can say with confidence that if they're going to strike one of these laws down, they're going to have to break new First Amendment ground above and beyond NIFLA or any of their other decisions.
Great. Thank you, Shannon and Maya. David, we'll hand it back to you now.
Okay. Yeah. We're all done.
We addressed all our topics.
That ended so fast. Okay. Well, first of all, I want to thank our panelists for coming out here tonight. I think they all deserve a round of applause. What a wonderful way to kick off the Humanist Legal Society with an event like this and distinguished panelists like this. It's really an honor for us. So thank you for being here, all three of you. And I also want to thank you all for coming out here today. It was a great event, and it's great to see this kind of a turnout for our first, our inaugural event as a Humanist Legal Society. I think our panelists will be sticking around for a little while if you'd like to chat and mingle a little bit and talk about some of the things that came up today. And there'll also be Legal Society and American Humanist Society staff around. Feel free to chat with us about the group and what we plan to do. If you have filled out any of the forms that were on your chairs, you can hand them to anyone with one of these AHA Legal Society name tags, and we'd be glad to take them. Please visit our website, humanistlegalsociety.org. We're really seeing this group as having great potential. I hope you see some of the potential for a group like this. What better time for a Humanist Legal Society than the summer of 2018 with what's going on in jurisprudence, huh? So thank you again.